I just want to finish today our four-week series on hashtag relationship goals. We've talked about marriage, we've talked about finding the right one, we've talked about sex. I mean, anything having to do with relationships, we've been talking. Last week, Pastor Robin talked about your power, that your partnerships bring you prosperity. In fact, if you don't have enough partners, you won't even be able to bring in the prosperity God wants to bless you with. And I want to take it a little bit further this week. You know, I remember when I was in high school, my senior year in high school, my parents moved from Wisconsin, where we lived, to the state of Minnesota halfway through my high school senior year. Now, folks, if you've been to in junior high and high school, you know, for 6 years with the same people, you know, we had about 2,500 in our high school. I mean, they're all my friends. I had lots of friends. I was like Donald Trump, you know, great athlete, you know, some of the things. Anyway, I'm just saying. I had a lot of friends. And the thing is, I didn't want to leave 6 months before I graduated. I don't want to go to a strange place and graduate with people I never met before. I begged my parents to let me stay in Wisconsin. I said, I promise, just let me stay with my... And so they asked the youth pastor of our church if he and his wife would keep me. Of course, my dad was the pastor. He was taking a new church. And they said, sure, you got to pay us so much money. So mom and dad sent him so much money a month. And then I had some odd jobs that I tried to, you know, make ends meet, put gas in my car. But I didn't have enough money for food. And I felt bad about saying this to mom and dad because they were already paying, you know, for housing for me. And the youth pastor's wife didn't have a lot, and they had a couple kids too, and I was staying in the basement. And so they really weren't feeding me. And so I'm kind of hungry. Are you with me? And thank God I had three really good friends. Michael Jackson. Now, Michael and I were about 6 years older than the one that you're all thinking about. Okay, Michael Jackson, also African-American, 6'5". He was the star defensive end, star offensive wide receiver, and star center on our basketball team, my dearest friend. And Murray Jackson, and Scott Laybourne. Scott was a year in front of us. Scott graduated, and instead of going to university right away, worked a year. He wanted to go to university with us. But for years, Michael Jackson had been saying, "Pat, Rich, I need 50 cents during the week. I need 50 cents. You know, get a sandwich or something for lunch." And I'd always give him 50 cents. And then Murray was always saying, "Hey, can I come over to the house? Michael, want to come over there? Get mom's, my mom's cooking. Can I come here?" So they'd come over and they'd eat, for, you know. And Scott was always coming over, and I was always taking him out. And we'd double date, and then I'd pay for he and his girlfriend, too. Just for years I did that. Now I got 6 months, I got no food. And so I sat him down and said, "Guys, I'm in a lot of trouble. I got gas for my car, but I don't have any money to eat on. Y'all got to help me." Michael Jackson's mom added a lunch every day for lunch. She made an extra sack lunch. And every day Michael would come after all these years of me giving 50. "Here you go, bro. He gave me 50. He gave me a sack full of lunch that Mrs. Jackson would make." And then Murray Jackson's mother would make me breakfast. She would have some kind of a hard-boiled egg and something to roll or something, donut. And I'd get to school, I'd get that to eat. And then Michael would bring the lunch sack. And then at dinner, Scott would get off of work. He'd come pick me up at the house about 5:30, say, "Let's go." And we'd head to McDonald's. And somehow, by the grace of God, those guys got me through to graduation. I did not die of starvation. Why? Because I had partners. It wasn't a one-way street. I'd been blessing them for years. Now they're blessing me when I got nothing. And you heard me talk last night, some of you. My wife and I got married to her 43 years ago. I'm going to tell you something. I've never been alone since I got married to her. I got a partner. We have been this dynamic duo for 43 years. Partnership. And I got this great staff of people here at Trinity Church, 130 employees, about 15 or 20 key friends that have been with me for years on this team who are dearest friends. Partnership. Things don't just happen in your life. You need partners. I want to read a passage of Scripture. And by the way, when you came in the door, on your chair was the notes for today. I want you to follow along with me. 1 Samuel 14, verses 6 and 7, a very familiar passage of scripture. I want to read it to you. Jonathan said to his young armor bearer, "Come, let's go over to the outpost of those uncircumcised men. Perhaps the Lord will act in our behalf. Nothing can hinder the Lord from saving, whether by many or by few." "Do all that you have in mind," his armor bearer said. "Go ahead. I am with you, heart and soul." Today, I want to talk to you in this final session on this thought, the power of partnership. The power of partnership. When you hear the story of Jonathan and his armor bearer, you're listening to a legendary, historical, unbelievable story that actually occurred in history. And it's legendary in the historical sense, not in the fact that it's a legend. It actually happened. It's just famous the world over in every part of the world. The Philistines had come in such a powerful way that Israel chickened out. The Bible says they were hiding out for fear of the Philistines. Jonathan was a mighty young warrior. In fact, his dear friend was a young man by the name of David, who later became King David. And both of them were fearless warriors. That's probably why they were such best friends. Jonathan got tired of hiding like a chicken. So one day he looks at his armor bearer and says, "Come on, let's go take those Philistines." Folks, this was a vast army, huge. And there's two young guys. "Let's go take those Philistines out. We'll show them a lesson." Now you can go, the guy's an idiot, and probably he was. But you see, Jonathan believed that God was with him. And Jonathan also knew he had a young partner who was committed to him as well. Now, here's the deal. What would happen if every last one of you in this room today was absolutely convinced that God is with you? Furthermore, what would happen if not only did you know God is with you, but you had a close friend who was as committed to God as you are and was also committed to you and your dreams? I'm going to tell you something, folks. There's nothing that could stop you. Nothing could stop you. I want to talk today for just a few moments on this thought of what a true partner is. The first thing I want to say about true partnership is this. A true partner is with you heart and soul. Heart and soul. Look what the young man said to Jonathan. "Do all that you have in mind," his armor bearer said. "Go ahead. I'm with you heart and soul." Now, the heart is not talking about the muscle that pumps blood to your body. What's being referred to here is the seat or the place in your life that houses your will and your emotions. Your heart says, "I will." Your heart says, "I will not." Your heart says, "I feel like I want to trust you." See the emotion of it, the decision making of it? That's your heart. "I'm with you. I'm for you. I believe in you." That's your heart. Your mind is your soul. Your soul is your mind. When he said, "I'm with you, heart and soul," he says, "I'm deciding for you because my mind says I believe in you, or I don't believe in you, or I believe I can trust you, or you're not trustworthy, or I've evaluated the situation. I believe I can stand with you." So he was saying, "I've made an intellectual decision to join you. I am with you heart and soul." Not just with my decisions, but with my mind. I'm all in. Hallelujah. When you have a partner like that, that's a very difficult thing for someone else to come up against. Very difficult. Because you're with someone heart and soul. Let me say this. Jonathan was a God man. That's one reason why the armor bearer trusted him. He thought, this guy's a God man. I've watched him throughout the years. I know I can trust him. He usually hears from God. I'm going with Jonathan. Always choose a God man. Always choose a God woman. Don't partner with losers. Don't partner with idiots. If you run into someone and they go, hey, who do you think? Hey, you look stupid. Why would you want to get to know someone like that? To me, they signaled who they are. But some of you go, oh, man, I got to get to know you, man. I know I can win you over. Shoot. I don't want to win that enemy over. Let him crash and burn, then come for me. I'll help him then. Don't tell me, yeah, don't call me an idiot and then want me to be your friend. No, 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 no. No, I'm going to choose a God man going in. I'm going to choose a God woman going in. I'm not going to look to lose in the situation. I'm going to choose someone as a partner who I know is going to help me along the way in my call from Almighty God. Can you say amen, church? Look at what the scripture says here in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 through 17. Do not be yoked together with idiots. Excuse me. Unbelievers. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship does light have with darkness? What harmony is there between Christ and the devil? Or what does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? What agreement is there between the temple of God and idols? For we are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will live with them and walk among them. And I will be their God and they will be my people. Therefore, come out from them and be separate, says the Lord. Touch no unclean thing and I will receive you. I want to be received by God, so I've got to pick partners who are going to be God-fearing men and women as well, so we can do life together and take the devil down. Hallelujah. These two young men decided to do the unthinkable, the impossible. He believed in him. The armor bearer believed in Jonathan. He was willing to die for Jonathan. Bible says the two of them showed themselves to this mass army. Two guys. Can you imagine? Two guys. We're going to go take ISIS out. We're going to kill them all. Two guys. So they showed themselves, and the Bible says immediately when they showed themselves, they headed towards the Philistines. And immediately, Jonathan and his armor bearer killed 20 men. Two guys killing 20 men. Now someone goes, oh, that's great. What do you mean great? Could you kill one man if it was hand-to-hand combat? Could you kill two by yourself? Three. Two guys take on 20 and knock them all out. At that point, the Bible says, God sent a panic to the Philistine army. Now, folks, you know what we need as a church? We need to be so together and so on the same page and so in partnership with each other that the devil begins to fear a panic sent from God. That God says, those people are fighting for me. Those people are on my side. Those people are in love with each other. They're moving forward. I'm going to send a panic throughout the ungodly of this area so that they begin to yield to the will of God and not the will of the devil. Amen? The Bible says that he sent a panic through the Philistines so that the Philistine army began turning on each other and thinking each other was their enemy, and they started killing each other, at which point the Israelites who were in hiding came out of hiding and said, we got him now! Because of two guys who were in partnership. What did these two young men bring to the table? I'll tell you what they brought to the table. These two young men, Jonathan and his armor bearer, they brought to the table teamwork. They brought to the table the idea of we believe and we will do this. We, not I. When you move out of the I category and into the we category, now you become unbelievably, exponentially more powerful. The Bible said, as I preached last Sunday night, one can put 1,000 to flight, but two can put 10,000 to flight. Sir, when you marry her, ma'am, when you marry him, and you're two God-fearing people, all of a sudden your potential went from one person to two people together, now doing five times the power that one person was doing. A quintuple anointing upon the power of two versus the power of just one. I'm going to tell you something. There's nothing like partnership. Your power is in your partnership. All right? The second thing I want to say about partnership is this. The power of partnership is in its fluidity. Say fluidity. The power of partnership is in its fluidity, meaning that it can change or flow with adversity. There were some people come up against adversity. They're by themselves, and all of a sudden, and change for them means running like a scared chicken. That's not God's will. Adversity is always meant for the believer to be strong, to be made stronger and not weaker. Not to run and hide like a chicken, but to move forward like a valiant warrior. And partnership is able to flow, and it has an ability to adapt to adversity and challenging stimuli. Look at this passage of scripture in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verses 9 through 12. You've heard it so many times. I want to read it again. Two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. See that? Fluidity. One's down, the other one's up. Helps one down, up. Two down people get hard to get up. One's down, one's up. Up and up, up and down, bringing it up. That was in Creole. Okay. But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. Also, if two lie down together, they'll keep warm. Hello. But how can one keep warm alone? Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken, the wisest man who ever lived. Solomon said this. See the fluidity there. See the adaptability that a partnership of two has. One falls down, the other one picks him up. Let me say this about my wife and I. I'm always cold. She's always hot. I don't just mean good looking, which she is. In fact, she was in the 11:30 service. I had her stand just so the people could see how hot looking she is. She is, her body, her temperature, she's hot. Always. I get it. She's always trying to get cold. She's always trying to get cool. Our bedroom, the air conditioning has some kind of a hyper steroidal kind of a, I've never seen air conditioning that can get this low without freezing up. And I promise you, every night I get in bed with a wool cap over my ear. I'm serious. I got a sweatshirt and pants on, and I get in, and I'll sit there, and she's laying there on the bed, and I go, baby, I'm just so cold. And she'll say, get over here. And she'll pull me over, and she'll put her legs around me, arms, my neck, and cradle my neck, I'm behind, like that. And about 10 minutes, I go, move away, move away. I'm. She's so hot, I'm just warmed up, like I promise. And whenever this happens, I think of this verse. Two lying down together, you stay warm. I go, man, she doesn't just get me warm, I get hot. My God. I'm just trying to be biblical. I'm just rehearsing the word of God. They're just please keep it clean. I'm just rehearsing the word of God. Just trying to stay with the Bible here, okay? If you're by yourself and you get attacked, how will you do? How will you do if you have a crowd of people attacking you by yourself? But If you have a partner with you, they can go to your back and you can move in a circle and you're back to back and you can fight each other off and somehow you can win if you've got partnership. That's what is being said by the wisest man who ever lived, Solomon. I remember, like it was yesterday, I was 20 years old. And it was the fall of 1972. I would be married in January of 73. And I was in my office. I was a youth pastor in Fort Worth, Texas. And I went to school 3 days a week, about 50 miles away near Dallas. Would come back and stay at the office till late at night. And I was in the office on one of the days that I didn't go to school. And one of the assistants, secretaries, we called them secretaries in those days, said, Rich, you have a friend is here that you've never met, but he wants to meet you, Alton Garrison. And I had briefly heard of him because he was a Southwest preacher. He was in the Southwest states, Arkansas, Louisiana, Oklahoma, Texas, New Mexico, that part of the world. And he was a single guy. He was 4 or 5 years older than me. And Alton traveled. He could play the keyboard and sing, and then he could just preach the house down. He was one of those Southern preachers, you know, powerful preacher. And I'd never met him, but I'd heard of him, and he just wanted to meet me. Because I was in this kind of a famous church at the time. Not that I was, but the church itself was. And my uncle pastored the church, and my uncle's name was Ira Stanfill, who 50 years ago was one of the most famous gospel songwriters in the world. And so Alton had played and sung my uncle's songs for many years, wanted to meet Uncle Ira. So Uncle Ira wasn't there, but I was here. Well, let me meet him, you know. Thought he could get to my uncle through me, I guess. I don't know. And he came and sat down. I said, man, I've heard you're doing a good job here. I said, man, you didn't hear that. I just got here. I'm not doing anything. I don't even know what I'm doing. I'm 20. And, of course, he was like 25. So I'm going, you're brilliant. You're smart. You're 5 years older than me. You know all things knowable. And so he was like a big brother to me. And we developed this relationship, this friendship. And years later, I was on the road traveling like out. But he was now pastoring in North Little Rock, Arkansas. And he called me, said, you got to come. And I went and preached there. And then I spoke in all the high schools of Little Rock, Arkansas. And then all the junior highs the next time I was there. And just probably 25 different schools. And we had hundreds and hundreds of students come to faith in Christ, and our meetings would be jammed every time I ever went to Little Rock, Arkansas at Alton's church. Just jammed. We just developed a better and better friendship, and then he became the district superintendent. After he left my office at the age of 20, I got married to Robin, and I was in my junior year at Southwestern University just outside of Dallas. And in the last half of my junior year, I had to take a class on pastoral marriage crisis counseling. So I've been married for like 3 years. Right? So I'm in this class for marriage crisis counseling. Now, you know, if we had a problem, we just went to bed that night and everything would be healed. I'd only been married for 3 or 4 months. So I'm thinking to myself, you're going to have a problem in marriage? You're going to have crisis counseling? Are you kidding me? Just go to bed, have sex, and you'll be healed. Now that's the way a 21-year-old kid would look at it at the time. So you know, I'm in this class with this guy named Dr. James Bridges. And he's like, I'm like 20. He's like 35 or maybe 40. And I kept asking these stupid questions because I was so happy to be married. I thought, how could there ever be a crisis? Are you kidding me? All right, well, this must be a foreign language to most people in the world. I said, are you sure people need this teaching? And he got so absolutely broken up with laughter at my questions for an entire semester that he kind of fell in love with me as like a little brother, you know? And I was a little bit older than his two sons. And so Dr. Bridges and his wife and kids became my friend. And he accepted me. And, you know, years later, Dr. Bridges became the district superintendent of North Texas District Council of the Assemblies of God. He had about 500 churches were under his care. And he would have me come and preach these big conferences and these district councils. And everyone thought I was a big deal. And I go, well, you're absolutely correct. You know, I was trying to be humble, but I wasn't doing a good job. But Dr. Bridges became a good friend. Well, now I got Alton Garrison's a good friend. Well, let's fast forward a bunch of years to 2005. I'm here in Miami. We're in the tent at I-95 and 125th Street. And Hurricane Frances hits Miami about a week and a half before Hurricane Wilma came and devastated Miami and Fort Lauderdale. And it just shredded our tent. Now, we were 3 or 4 months away from being able to move into this building. So here we are. We got this big church. We're getting ready to move into this big building. And our tent is shredded. I mean, it's just flapping in the wind out there. And we're flat broke because we bought this gazillion-dollar building. And every last dime has gone into this. And it's not quite finished yet. It's got 4 more months before we can move in. And now we got to move back in the A-frame. Some of you were there with me when it happened. And we had about 4 services in the A-frame to try to get everybody in there. And the week this happened, Dr. Alton Garrison called me. Remember the guy that was the preacher when I was 20 years old, came to meet me, wanted to meet my uncle, met me and said he was 25, I was 20. He's now the assistant general superintendent of the Assemblies of God in the United States of America, almost 13,000 churches. Always be nice to people. 100 years ago, because you don't know where those people are going to end up. Can I get an amen? You meet someone, always be nice. Always show generosity. Always do an act of kindness for them. Always be hopeful. Don't go, well, who do you think you are? Don't go there. Just be nice. And Dr. Garrison called me, said, Rich. I said, Alton, oh, God. He goes, I hear you got trouble. I go, I got trouble right here in River City. I'm telling you, it is really bad. He goes, I hear the tent's destroyed. I said, it's destroyed. I said, we're 4 months out from getting our new building. I said, we're back in the A-frame. We had to paint it. I said, I can't. I don't have a buck. He goes, I'm going to call our mutual friend, Dr. James Bridges. Remember Dr. Bridges? Crisis counseling in marriage. Are you nuts? There's no crisis in marriage. By the way, I've had about 228,000 crises in my marriage since I took that class, and that class didn't help me at all. I just want to say that. Didn't help any of my counseling either, because as you know, Rich, Dr. Bridges and I are close friends. He is the treasurer of the Assemblies of God here in America. And I believe we have some funds in our disaster relief that will help Trinity Church. I said to him, Harabasanda. I couldn't answer in English. I was in tongues. I'm sorry. That's all I could do, okay? I said, well, just call me back. He calls me back an hour later. He's got Dr. Bridges on the extension phone. And Dr. Bridges, Rich, how you doing? He's just a big old Texan, you know. How you doing? I hear things are bad. Alton tells me things are bad down there. I said, things are really bad, Doc. I'm Dr. Bridges, and I'm bad. I need crisis counseling myself. I'm just a man, not even marriage, just my whole life. I'm messed up. He said, well, we got a few extra dollars in the emergency disaster relief fund. We're going to send you $100,000 this week to Trinity Church. Now, folks, how'd that happen? Did they just have pity on us? No, they knew us. We'd been partners for 40-something years. Are you with me, church? We had already been in partnership. We always already believed in each other. We'd been helping each other out already. And so when a big problem comes down and little brother is really lying down hurt in the road, they come along and pick the young boy up and say, hey, we're going to help you out. You'll get going again. And hallelujah, that's been years ago, and God is still blessing us. It's called partnership. Now, here's a question. How is it that we here at Trinity Church are in such great victory on a regular basis? And I don't take any credit for it. We're in this thing together. I think the reason why God has given us victory on a regular basis is because we are in partnership together. When one's down, we pick him up. When I'm down, you pick me up. I have a shoulder surgery. People don't say, well, he's trying to get a week off. No. Everyone starts praying. Let's pray for the pastor. You see, we're not like questioning. We're not, oh, I wonder what the real problem is. You know, we just accept it. Hey, we believe. We're straight up. We're on. We're with you. We're going to believe God with you. When one's hot, the other one's cold. One's cold, the other one's hot. We're there. We're fighting together. We are a united front against the attack of the devil. Hallelujah. How did it happen? Lots of teaching, Lots of trials, lots of struggles, but we've agreed on our core values. And that's on the back of your notes. Write them down real quickly. Our core values. You've heard them a million times, but I want to say them one more time. Jesus is our message. Say it out loud. Jesus is our message. Say it out loud, people. People are our heart. Excellence. Say it with me. Excellence is our spirit. Generosity, say it with me. Generosity is our privilege. Say it with me, honor. Honor is our calling. How do you meet people? How do you talk to people? You walk up to people with this, who do you think you are? Those kind of people wear me out. Do you ever honor anybody? See, I want to live an honorable life. I want to meet you and honor you the day I see you. I don't want to wait for you to do something dirty to me. I'm going in first. You know, it's a pleasure to meet you. I'm so thankful you're here today. You don't know what it means to me to have you as part of our team today. Here at See, all of a sudden, that kind of honor throws some people, whoa, I was going to spit on him, but now I can't because he was honorable. Now I got to be honorable. See, when you move that way first, people respond with honor. Servant leader, say it with me. Servant leadership is our identity. And finally, passion is our pursuit. Passion is our pursuit. Anything we do with energy. You know, we don't go, hey, how's it going? Hey, how's it going? And we don't go, fine. We go, great. You see, we speak to the future we want. We're not talking about the present that's right here. We speak to the future we're believing for. I may not feel right, real good right now. How you doing, Pastor Rich? Oh, hallelujah. Ha, ha. I'm just, whoa. I want to talk about what I'm believing for. Passion is our pursuit. Now, let me just say this finally before we pray. We're talking about partnership, that our power is in our partnership. We talked about a true partner is with you heart and soul. We talked about partnership is so unique because of its fluidity. It can adapt to situations and changes. But last of all, the power of partnership begins by partnering with Jesus. It's all about, first of all, partnering with Jesus Christ. Here's what Jesus said in Matthew 18, 19. Again, truly I tell you, that if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. He was talking about the power of agreement. And you cannot have agreement if you don't have a partner. Agreement is about partnership with someone, to agree with someone about something. And I know there's people that say, well, Pastor Richard, that's my big issue. I don't have any partners here on earth. I'm not very attractive. I'm packing a little extra weight. I don't have what I need for clothes, and I don't. People aren't attractive. Let me tell you something. The first question you should be asking yourself is, do I have partnership with Jesus Christ? Because once you are full on with Jesus Christ, He will give you partners here on this earth. You've been looking for something that you can't get on your own, but once Jesus is your partner, He'll bring them into your life. See, Jesus in you becomes very attractive. I've seen people initially who on face value aren't that attractive, but all of a sudden, for some reason, I'm drawn to them. I'm attracted. I'm going, why would I? What in the world? What's going on? All of a sudden, as I get to know him, I'm going, my goodness, wow, there's something about this guy. He's so full of God. He's so full of Jesus. I got to get to know him better. I want to be his partner. I want to know him better. That's what Jesus does in a person's life. It is true that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. I want you to know this afternoon, before we bring this meeting to an end, that you are looking at a God-man. You're looking at an all-out Jesus man. Full-on for Jesus. I learned as a young man that if I had Jesus as a partner, there's not a blooming thing the devil could do to take me down. I'm telling you, I mean, that's been years and years ago. You're looking at a Jesus man. I'm full on for Jesus. I'm not boasting in that. I'm just boasting in Him. He's all I've got. I'm nothing without Jesus. I don't have a wife. I don't have four sons and three beautiful daughters. And I don't have grandkids. I don't have miracles. I don't have a house to live in. I don't have a car. I don't have a church that loves me. I don't have a staff that works with me. I don't have anything without Jesus. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. But make no mistake about it. He is my way. He is my truth. He is my life. He's my partner. And because He's my partner, He's given me a number of partners here on earth that have turned the tables against the devil every time. And it is my joy to send the devil running every day of my life. It's the thrill of my heart. Today, God wants to do the same in your life. You need a partner. I want you to bow your head with me.